again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies chase those dark clouds far away.
60 years ago, in September 1944, Gelderland was still occupied, but help was on the way. The Allies were advancing from France and Belgium through Gelderland in their drive towards Berlin. The operation became known as Market Garden. Perhaps it's better known as the Battle of Arnhem, although Market Garden was much more than that. The advance through Gelderland didn't go according to plan. The bridge here at Arnhem was so heavily defended by the Germans that it was impossible to take. Market Garden partly turned out to be a dramatic battle. We will reconstruct Operation Market Garden in four parts. We'll show how the operation should have gone. Veterans describe their experiences, and local people recall their memories from those days. Well, then it started. The walls began to shake, and the chaplain said, "Let's not pray, let's finish the service as quickly as possible, because we don't know what's going to happen."
We weten ook niet wat er gaat gebeuren.
You're very, very nervy and scared. Any person that tells you they're not frightened is not telling the truth.
On paper, Market Garden seemed a clear and effective plan. Airborne troops would take the most important bridges in Brabant and Gelderland in a few days, after which British ground forces would advance from Belgium via Eindhoven and Nijmegen to Arnhem. Once across the Rhine, the army would continue on to Berlin to bring Nazi Germany to its knees. And the Second World War would be over by Christmas, but it didn't turn out like that. 6 June 1944, the battle for Europe has begun. Hundreds of thousands of Allied troops poured out of England to the continent to crush the world enemy. The liberation of Western Europe begins on D-Day on the 6th of June 1944 with the Allied invasion of the Normandy beaches. Paris is liberated in August, and at the beginning of September, British troops triumphantly enter Brussels and Antwerp. But it is precisely the speed of the Allies' advance which creates difficulties and slows down its momentum. Until then, they had not been able to capture any usable harbors, meaning that supplying the troops has to take place over long distances from improvised harbors in Normandy. The supply of food and other materials is therefore limited, and the commander of the British Second Army calls a halt for several days. An important reason for the delay is the discussion between the British and the Americans. They have difficulty agreeing on the next strategic moves. The difference of opinion between the British and Americans concerns the route to Berlin. The Americans favor northern France and the Alsace. The British prefer the Dutch rivers and the Ruhr, and then the advance to Berlin. The British win the day. The way forward will be through Gelderland.
Now British Field Marshal Montgomery brings Supreme Commander Eisenhower a daring plan. A narrow front instead of a broad front. A single knife stab into Holland, bridging the Rhine. Outflanking the Siegfried Line, seizing the Ruhr, the road to Berlin, and lightning victory. The key? An airborne carpet. The American 101st and 82nd dropping at Eindhoven and Nijmegen, the British 1st at Arnhem. British ground forces will roll along this carpet across five rivers, including the Rhines. Eisenhower approves Market Garden.
But because the strategic discussion between the Allies lasts 5 days, the Germans have the opportunity to regroup. Two SS panzer divisions are stationed in the area around Arnhem. No one took this into account. A German soldier grabbed me and threw me into a foxhole. He then jumped on top of me. I suppose that's what saved me.
We hebben meegemaakt dat 's avonds dat je kon zien uit ons ouderlijke huis dat de Duitsers.
The Germans went into houses and set the curtains alight to burn the houses down.
Maar zo vlammen, bijvoorbeeld om alles maar onveilig te maken.
My father said there are Germans around. I remember we were very surprised that three officers were shot on the spot. Suddenly, Germans were everywhere and they began shooting. Executing those people, even although they were hated Germans, my parents especially were anti-German, we really didn't like that. It was hand-to-hand combat, everything was set ablaze, it was very dangerous. Operation Market Garden was the brainchild of British Field Marshal Montgomery and consisted of two elements, an air operation and a ground operation. This map clearly shows what its aims were. The air operation Market was intended to capture the most important bridges in Brabant and Gelderland. In Brabant, these were at Son, St. Odenrode, Veghel and Grave. In Gelderland, they were at Malden, Nijmegen and Arnhem. Three lightly armed airborne brigades were deployed to capture the bridges at Eindhoven, Nijmegen and Arnhem. This involved three drops spread over 3 days. They were lightly armed because airborne troops cannot carry a lot of kit. The heavy weapons, such as tanks, would be deployed during the second part of the Operation Garden. This consisted of Allied ground forces from Belgium, which would make use of the captured bridges. Everything is ready on the 17th of September 1944. Operation Market Garden begins.
At 24 air bases in Britain, Market, the vast and delicate airborne half, is prepared. 34,000 men, 1,500 planes, 478 gliders.
And it was a lovely Sunday morning, summer shining, beautiful. All got in our planes, and we knew where we were going then. We said we were going to a place called Arnhem, and we were going the furthest afield than most of them, about 60 miles beyond the lines.
Artillery bombardments were launched prior to the landings to destroy the German positions, which would be a threat to the planes flying in from England to Eindhoven, Nijmegen and Arnhem.
Elk regiment kreeg zijn eigen landingsgebied aangewezen. Dat werd met een codenaam genoemd. Dus bijvoorbeeld.
Every regiment was assigned a landing zone. This was designated by a code name. Several people had been dropped about 90 minutes before the landings. Their task was to mark the landing zone with white flags, a sort of bedsheet. This also indicated the wind direction.
Ja, je zou zeggen lakens, witte stroken. En dan moesten ze dan de windrichting aangeven in de vorm van een T, of het een noordoostenwind was of noordelijke wind.
En de troopers were stacked in the C-47, 9 men on each side, 18 troopers. People are a certain amount of tents operation, but sitting in the door as I was, I breathing fresh air, enjoying the Dutch countryside, I don't think there wasn't any anything that would upset or panic anybody. And we had a job to do. We were well briefed. We knew where we were going, what our mission was.
Probably we used at least four or five airports. And then the 101st and the British 1st, they also had a large number of aircraft and airports. So it was a huge marshalling effort. I'd say we're looking at this as the most, I'd say the most challenging airborne operation after Sicily, after Italy, even Normandy. This was going to be what I call the big drive. And if we were successful, we'd turn the Siegfried line and we'd be into Berlin.
A total of 16 airfields in England were involved in the operation. The Dakotas formed a long line in the air because they had to be alert for German air attacks.
Want je moest oppassen dat je niet aangevallen werd door Duitse jagers, hè, van links en rechts. Dus elke minuut,
every minute, and even sometimes every 30 seconds, a plane would take off and take its position in the long line heading for the Netherlands.
In die lange luchttrein richting Nederland.
The sun was shining on Sunday, the 17th of September, 1944, just like today. Now the sky is blue, but in 1944, parts of the sky in Brabant and Gelderland must have been black with parachutes. Here in Grave, the first relatively small group of paratroops from the 82nd U.S. Airborne Division lands at 1 o'clock right next to the bridge. Their mission was to take the bridge the very same day. At 5 o'clock, they capture the bridge, a great success. This monument marks the event. The paratroops dropped in the fields near Overasselt and Nederasselt also land safely. That same evening, the sluice bridge over the Maas-Waal Canal was captured. Of the 7,500 men from the American division, 4,000 land in the fields around Groesbeek, south of Nijmegen, including General James Gavin. This group is responsible for seizing the rail and road bridges at Nijmegen. There was a lot of noise in the air, so we knew it wasn't 5 or 10 planes, it was hundreds. I looked around and saw the bombers coming, both 4 and 2 engines. I looked again carefully and saw planes hanging behind them without engines.
Ik kijk nogmaals en dan zie ik dat een vliegtuig achterhangt zonder motoren eraan.
We were at the table, and someone shouted, planes, parachutes, they're jumping. A fantastic sight. But at the same time, I thought, the fighting's going to start. I watched it for about an hour or an hour and a half, but I was also nervous. Of course, it was very exciting. Father grabbed a chair and sat quietly watching. A fantastic sight. It was a great day.
No, prachtig gezicht was het. Het was een mooie dag.
Towards the evening, we looked to the west. Of course, we'd never seen anything like it. And it was as if a matchbox had been opened and the matches floated down to earth. They were the paratroops. You got the best view from the Amsterdam Road. I went there with some people. Anyway, I was allowed onto the roof. From there, I could see the landings. Okay, in the distance, they were just like small dots, but still, a great sight, a very impressive moment.
Ja, geweldig gezicht natuurlijk, een uitermate indrukwekkend iets.
I went into the village again. The first Americans had arrived. It was a great atmosphere, naturally. What happened then? The whole village was deliriously happy. But in the evening we felt differently, because we heard the heavy guns. Damn, we thought. Aren't we liberated yet? Things start to go wrong for the 82nd Division almost right from the start. General Gavin is almost killed. He lands at the edge of the woods with his staff. He heads towards the Wolfsburg Hotel. He is shot at from the woods by a German sniper. Harry Besterbroertje is with General Gavin. He is the liaison officer for the Netherlands Forces of the Interior. He eliminates the sniper with one shot and thereby prevents chaos from breaking out among Gavin's men, which would have immediately threatened the operation. General Gavin has two clear mission objectives. First, seal off the city of Nijmegen from Germany. And secondly, capture the bridge.
Our job was to secure a crossing of the Waal River so the British forces coming up from down Eindhoven and coming this way could cross the Waal River and get on to the troops up in the bridge too far at Arnhem.
There was a huge misunderstanding between the commander of the battalion and General James Gavin. Gavin assumed he had given clear orders the previous evening. Proceed to the bridge at Nijmegen and seize it.
Jullie gaan naar die brug in Nijmegen, pak het meteen.
Instead, the commander went to the Seanshof Hotel and thought, I have to wait here for a signal from Gavin to attack. It is precisely those 6 wasted hours at the Seanshof Hotel which were used by the Germans to send reinforcements from Arnhem to the bridge at Nijmegen.
The Germans were well in place. They were in the basements of the concrete buildings. They had some... appeared to be anyway anti-tank type weapons, and very difficult to root out because they're a very determined enemy.
General Gavin ordered them to send one battalion to take the bridge. We didn't have enough strength to knock the Germans off the bridge. You know, the Volkhof is the old medieval fortress. It's heavily fortified, and the Germans, I guess, anticipated something because they had extra weapons. They had their 20, 40 millimeters, they had their 88s, they had their mortars. They were well dug in. So our best efforts on the 17th and 18th, we couldn't do it.
At 20:00 hours, General Gavin discovered that the battalion was still in the Seanshof Hotel. He became very angry and ordered them to attack the bridge. They left the hotel at 20:00 hours, crossed the Groesbeekse Weg, and arrived at the large traffic roundabout at midnight. This was exactly where the Germans had dug in, waiting for the Americans. There were heavy exchanges from around midnight until 1 or 2 in the morning. A fight the Americans lost. The battalion was more or less cut to ribbons.
Amerikanen verloren, dus dat bataljon is min of meer in de pan gehakt.
Heavy fighting is taking place for the bridges in Nijmegen. In the meantime, a lot is going on here to the west of Arnhem. At 1 o'clock, the first gliders full of troops, weapons and even jeeps make their descent into the fields at Wolfheze and Heelsum. The paratroops are dropped here 1 hour later. The aim of the 1st British Airborne Division, commanded by General Roy Urquhart, is to seize the Rhine Bridge at Arnhem. Strategically speaking, one of the most important bridges of the entire operation.
The
The fighter planes carried on shooting with machine guns, and at the beginning of the afternoon, we saw more planes in the west. We wondered, are those the bombers coming to drop more bombs again? But we soon heard that airdrops had taken place near Renkum and Wolfhese. Eventually, we all quickly returned home and had a very strange experience. My mother, well, my father was with a Red Cross convoy and wasn't home. My mother was in the cellar with a pot on her head. Beside her were two large bottles of petrol my father had stored away. Not exactly a safe place to hide. It was very quiet, not a German to be seen. Were we liberated? We just didn't know. Various people had already dug out the national flag and hung it out. So there was a party atmosphere. When we got there, there were indeed British soldiers who drove past. We waved at them. They smiled a bit. There were a few Bren gun carriers, all heading for the bridge. We all went cheerfully back home, thinking, it won't be long until we are liberated. Right here in Hilsum, at the edge of the woods, John Frost blew a blast on his hunting horn. Frost is in command of a unit of the 1st British Airborne Division and gathers his men together. You have to realize that the troops who have landed are spread out over a large area, so they often have difficulty finding each other. John Frost solves this problem by blowing on his horn. Shall I try again? The distance between the landing zones in Hilsum and Wolfhese and the Rhine Bridge in Arnhem is about 15 kilometers. Landing closer to the bridge would have been too dangerous for the planes of the Royal Air Force because the German defensive guns are drawn up near the bridge. Moreover, little resistance is expected from the Germans here in Wolfhese and Hilsum, and there was sufficient space for successful landings. But there are also disadvantages. There can be no question of a surprise attack on the Rhine Bridge, and the German SS Panzer divisions, at that point in the Veluwe, have time to cut off important roads to the bridge and attack the British.
And we dropped on the landing zone, a place called Hilsum. They reckon it was about 8 miles from the bridge at Arnhem. We dropped very well and had no opposition whatsoever. The girls were running onto the DZ collecting the parachutes for the silk.
The battalion's first task was to proceed to the bridge at Arnhem. The 1st Battalion took the Amsterdam Road, but were quickly stopped by German units, which soon realized that something important was going on. They resisted the battalion and stopped its advance.
Not air, but ground opposition is to be the fateful problem. Outside of Arnhem, remnants of two SS Panzer divisions, the Freundsberg and the Hohenstaufen, arrive unexpectedly for rest and refitting.
The 3rd Battalion, which had advanced along the Utrecht Road, is also quickly stopped near Wolfhese and the outskirts of Oosterbeek.
So in the morning, after a nice night, as we thought, I decided to go and get a wash. I no sooner got out of the trench and they came over, what they call the dawn bombardment, and they just spattered us with shells. Men were going down on the left of us and the right, and we just could not understand what was happening. We found out then that going down to the bridge, there were two roads, and the Germans had split the road in two. So, in other words, we were separated from Arnhem.
And as we were passing the rear of the railway, we were fired on again, and that's where we had our first casualty, as far as I know. Johnny Frost decided to take an alternate route, and that's when we crossed down to the side of the river.
Only John Frost's 2nd Battalion was lucky enough to choose a route which had not yet been blockaded by the Germans, and so he could reach the bridge at Arnhem as early as Sunday evening.
John Frost called us back. He said, "We want to get to the bridge as soon as possible." He said, "Take your section and capture this end of the bridge." I said, "I've only got 7 men, sir." He said, "That's all. I'll send more up as soon as they come."
But eventually, I believe, the 2nd Battalion of 2 companies got down to the bridge, captured it, and were defending it.
After a day of toiling and fighting, the balance can be drawn up. The bridges over the Maas at Grave and the Maasvaal Canal have been taken, but the Germans have successfully dug in at the Waal Bridge. They easily repulsed the American attacks. In Arnhem, only John Frost Group has reached the Rhine Bridge, and they control the northern approach. In the meantime, the Allied ground troops are behind schedule. They have only reached Valkenswaard, while they should already have been in Eindhoven. Will they arrive on time to help the airborne troops in Gelderland offer resistance to the Germans? Will Frost succeed in holding the north end of the Arnhem Bridge until ground troops arrive? Find out in part 2.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when. But I know.
The first part dealt with the intensity of the launch of Operation Market Garden. On the 17th of September 1944, by means of fast maneuvers, airborne troops attempt to capture important road bridges in Brabant and Gelderland. The Allies could then push on towards Berlin. John Frost manages to seize a section of the Rhine Bridge in Arnhem from the Germans. The American commander, James Gavin, suffers a humiliating defeat in Nijmegen. On the road to the bridges across the Waal River, the Germans cut his forces to ribbons. The situation is precarious. It's unclear if the bridges over the Rhine and Waal will ever fall into Allied hands. How do you capture bridges that are heavily defended? Some bridges rapidly fall into Allied hands, but German resistance is unexpectedly fierce at the bridges at Nijmegen and Arnhem. The Germans do not hesitate to burn the houses near to the bridges to provide a clearer view of Allied troop movements. The second part of Market Garden deals with the battle for the most important bridges in Gelderland. The Germans were especially dangerous on the second night, as the large warehouse was no more than a shell. It had been destroyed during the February bombardment. Only the supports remained. If anyone emerged from the Pearsonstraat, they were immediately shot at. So we fled again, just like the previous day. But now there was more panic, because we were being fired upon. We hoped it would be over in a few days, but that wasn't the case. During the first few days, we could hear the grenades whistling over our heads from the direction of Arnhem. That was to keep the Americans at bay. And we thought, my goodness, strange things, those grenades. Later, they were dropped on us, in our own village. They came ever closer. The grenades were just like bombs when they fell, big, heavy and horrible things. We just didn't expect it, that the Germans would fight back, and so fiercely. Father went to bed that night, and we headed for the Utrecht Road. And what did we find? There, lying in the road, were the brains of a British soldier. Further on lay 2 Germans. The one had tried to help the other by placing him on a handcart, but they'd both been shot, and lay where they had fallen, in the Hartensteinlaan. We went back home, because we thought there would be a celebration, but it was nothing like that.
Als je dus denkt van we worden bevrijd, dan denk je aan een hoera stemming, maar er was toen nog geen sprake van.
Many military are killed and wounded as the battle rages for the bridges. But there is also hope for these young men. The British Army is slowly but surely drawing closer. On Sunday, the 17th of September, the first day of Market Garden, British ground forces are progressing slowly. It's taking longer than planned to reach the Dutch border, as the Germans are offering fierce resistance at the bridge in Neerpelt in Belgium. The first British tanks only reach Valkenswaard at 7:30 that evening. Orders from above dictate that the British would remain in place for the rest of that day. Next day, the first American paratroops penetrate the center of Eindhoven from their landing zone in Saan. Their position is weak, and the Germans take every opportunity to fire upon the Americans. At 7 p.m., the Americans finally receive support from the British. The liberation of Eindhoven has been achieved. The British are now in full flight, and they press on towards Gelderland. On Monday, the day of Eindhoven's liberation, James Gavin makes a second attempt to capture the bridges on the Waal. During the fighting, Gavin receives a message that the landing zone in Groesbeek has fallen to the Germans. This creates huge problems for the Allies. As 400 gliders have already left England and are heading for this landing zone. The Americans immediately withdraw from Nijmegen to recapture the sites from the Germans. They arrive just in time, and Gavin is able to prevent a disaster. The first tank crossed the bridge, an American tank. It passed the church. Behind it was a large farm, and it came under fire from there. I can still see the tank turning towards the farm. Two or three shots, and it went up in flames. I stood here with my sister and brother. My mother and father were over there. We were praying. We didn't dare leave the house. My father said, "I'm going to hang out a white sheet to show we surrender, because this is madness." We didn't know if they were Germans or British. We prayed a lot. Then you realize it's true what they say. You learn to pray in time of need. They began to shoot at each other while we were hiding in the cellar. We were afraid they would shoot us too. We had dug these emergency cellars. Then the Germans called out, "Schweinhunde!" And they started cursing. They knew they were in a tight spot. We heard more shooting as the day wore on, in the east, in the outskirts of Arnhem, and from the bridge. We heard from the Air Defense Service, my father was part of it, that heavy street fighting was taking place at the Brink.
Dat op het terrein van de Brink, zoals dat toen nog genoemd werd, het huidige Kema-terrein, zwaar gevochten werd.
This is the end, we thought. We won't survive this. The fighting was so fierce, I felt this was the end of my life.
Zo ging het de keer, hoor, ja.
After Gavin had recaptured the landing zones at Groesbeek on Monday, he begins his third attempt to capture the road and rail bridge at Nijmegen on Tuesday. It's the third day of Operation Market Garden. The advance units of ground troops reach Nijmegen. With the help of British tanks, General Gavin once again attacks the road and rail bridge held by the Germans. The German defenses are well organized with heavy guns, which they have set up on the south end of the Waal Bridge. They use anti-tank guns, which is perfect for stopping tanks. They have a range of around 2 kilometers, as well as having a larger version. This was deployed on the Trajanus plain in September
1944.
This is where it stood. It's a perfect strategic location for the Germans. From here, they can cover all the roads leading to the Waal Bridge. So, whatever route Gavin takes, his men will always be walking straight into the arms of the Germans.
elke keer rechtstreeks in de armen van de Duitsers.
Nor did the British tanks pose any threat for the large German guns. And so the third attempt to capture the bridges at Nijmegen also fails. James Gavin is desperate, but he doesn't give up and devises an alternative plan. On Tuesday morning, the third attempt to capture the bridges had failed and General Gavin had drawn up an alternative plan. We'll attack the bridges from both ends. By doing so, the defenders will not blow up the bridges because they will blow themselves up. Attacking bridges from both ends is a well-known strategy. He had selected a battalion from Alverna for this mission. They hadn't seen much action yet. They would cross the river in canvas boats.
All I remember, it was a slope like here. We were just laying there waiting for the boat. And then they come in the street higher like that and they say, here's the boat. And everybody started running and, you know, getting the boats and put them in the water.
Well, the engineers, they knew what was going on. I mean, they'd been briefed before they got to where they was to tell us that we were a bunch of kids and none of us knew anything about those boats or anything else. So as we got them off the rafts, and we was moving them up to where we could put them into where the water was.
The crossing was planned for 3 o'clock on the afternoon of the 20th of September. British fighters attacked the Germans beforehand, who had suspected something was going on. The Germans had positioned artillery in the old Hof van Holland fort. They had also set up a machine gun post behind the dike at Lent so they could see the American preparations. The RAF fighters attacked at 1400 hours. British tanks began firing from the south bank across the river at the German positions at the Hof van Holland a half an hour later. At 1500 hours, the crossing began.
And of course, once we got into the water itself, all we had was three oars and the engineer had one of those. So most of the people was using their rifle butts. I mean, if they had rifles, they were using their rifle butts themselves to help the boat, help move that boat across the water.
Like you said, we started up this way and then the current sort of took us down and got at the other end, probably someplace where those towers are, which is, it was pretty rough. And there was a lot of firing, a lot of people getting killed and all that, so a lot of commotion going on. I do remember that I pray a lot, but I don't remember whether I prayed loud or I was just mumbling. But and I keep saying to myself, why is this boat not moving fast enough? You know, you keep paddling with a rifle and all these people, you know, getting killed in the boats and all that. And then all these men hollering for help, and a lot of them wounded, some direct hits on the boat and the whole boat, everybody dying and all that. So that's basic, mostly what I remember.
Most of the soldiers couldn't swim. They were terrified. They were fired at from the rail bridge from a machine gun post. Of the 26 boats, only 13 reached the other side. The rest were riddled with bullets or capsized due to inexperienced paddling. In total, the crossing cost the lives of 52 men.
Well, I wouldn't call it frayed, but I would call it, I wasn't quite like I should be.
Well, I don't mind telling you, I was afraid. And I wasn't the only one.
No, there was a lot of them.
I would be lying if I would say, no, I wasn't afraid.
The 13 boats which did manage the crossing then returned with three sailors to fetch more forces. And so it went on the entire afternoon. As more men reached the other side, the easier it became to take the bridge. They then advanced on the rail bridge and captured it at 5 o'clock. Next came the advance on the road bridge. It was attacked at both ends at 1900 hours. A large group of British troops move around the Valkhof towards the Waalkade, from where they could attack the SS troops. Fighting also took place on the north bank. The road bridge was seized at 7 o'clock.
Because these guys are the heroes. They're the ones. You can see them in front.
Yeah.
No, face me. Huh. You can face me. Face me.
Face you, okay.
Okay. Tension? Tension? Salute? Move. We're the lucky ones.
It's been a long time.
John Frost and his men have been involved in heavy fighting with the Germans here in Arnhem for days. On Wednesday, the 20th of September, he still hasn't captured the northern approach to the Rhine Bridge. He doesn't see how he can manage to seize the south side from the Germans either. It is in fact the Germans who capture more ground, both in the city and around the bridge. The majority of the British forces who have been dropped are still located near Oosterbeek, and all their attempts to reach Frost at the Rhine Bridge are thwarted. They are constantly driven back by the German SS Panzer divisions. They cannot break through. They suffer enormous losses, and dead and wounded soldiers cover the streets of Arnhem. It becomes obvious that the Germans clearly go on the offensive. Whole columns of German troops appear on the Amsterdam Road. First a few on motorbikes, reconnaissance troops maybe, then infantry, soldiers, hundreds of them. They march in a kind of goose step, left and right of the bridge, towards Oosterbeek.
Toen wij langs de weg liepen om naar het station Hoog.
We went to the station.
Overal zag je
dead British soldiers everywhere. En, ja, dat a was terrible sight. We had received a message from the British to abandon our houses, as heavy fighting was about to take place.
Waar ons werd gevraagd om onze huizen te verlaten, omdat daar dus felle gevechten zouden plaatsvinden.
It turned out later that it was a British message, but spread by the Germans. We then left our house and spent two nights near the Hartenstein Hotel. The first night in a council depot and later in a cellar, under fire from the German artillery. I saw a smoke screen over the river. It began to drift away, and I saw the Americans. I saw the 82nd Division making the crossing in canvas boats. I only realized later that they were canvas. So, under heavy fire, they crossed over to Lent in small rowing boats with 7 or 8 men in them. I estimate about 82 or 87 men drowned or were shot during the crossing. There were about 35 to 40 men, sometimes about 60 prisoners of war. As a child, I was happy because we could see they were British. I remember them making the V for victory sign, but the people watching didn't respond because the prisoners were guarded by 6 or 7 Germans. They had, and I remember this very well, they had huge machine guns. I remember them being huge machine guns with long strings of bullets around their necks. In the evenings, when we were up in the attic and you looked out of the window, we could see a red glow over Arnhem, the market in the city centre, and so on. It was on fire.
binnenstad bij de markt en dergelijke, dat die zo in brand stond.
We had heard rumors about it, but now we could see everything was going up in flames.
Helemaal vuur en vlam was. Ja.
John Frost urgently needed help. If it didn't arrive on time, the Rhine Bridge would inevitably fall to the Germans and the entire operation would be in danger. The bridge at Nijmegen has been captured and ground troops can reach Frost at the Rhine Bridge within hours. But then, General Horrocks, Supreme Commander of the 30th British Army Corps, makes a huge tactical mistake. After capturing the bridges across the Waal, he decides against marching on Arnhem. Instead, his forces spend the night in Lent. The consequences of his decision are disastrous. From Sunday to Monday, things were relatively quiet at the bridge. The British forces at the bridge, John Frost and his men, held their positions. On Monday morning, the Germans attempted to attack and recapture the bridge from the east with small tanks. This failed, as the Allies had 6-pound cannon which could eliminate the German tanks. The Germans gave up any more attempts to capture the bridge from this side.
Went up to the steps, and as we got near the top, we could hear these German voices appeared over the top, and there was a German truck just parked about 5 yards away, or perhaps less than that. And the officer was talking to the men in the back, so I told my section behind to keep quiet a minute or two. And eventually this officer got in the truck and then he drove across the bridge. That's when I started walking alongside the bridge and we caught a couple of Germans and they're hiding in the corners of these huts. I sent them back and told them to bring a man to take them down as prisoners. And I started walking further up the bridge and that's when I saw this rifle sticking out. So I shouted to him, "Hand a hock," as I thought it was German. Anyhow, he just seen the silhouette of the rifle sticker raise up a little bit. So I jumped round to the right and started firing. But as I fired, he must have had his finger on the trigger and he just caught me in the top of the leg as he was falling. I was trying to feel round for my leg, couldn't find it, so I crawled back to get behind a girder because they were firing down this road, down the road now across the bridge. So I must have lay there for a couple of hours, I think. Well, it seemed a long time until the medics came and took me off to the first aid post.
During Tuesday and Wednesday, most of the action around the bridge involved house-to-house fighting. The Germans decided to set the houses alight. In this way, they could no longer be defended by the British. They keep on the move from house to house. Their positions north of the bridge grew smaller and smaller. At one point, a ceasefire was called to allow the wounded to be taken to German hospitals, after which fighting resumed.
Af te kunnen voeren naar Duitse ziekenhuizen, maar men is daarna gewoon weer verder gegaan met de gevechten.
They ran out of ammunition and food. There were no more bandages to treat the wounded, and they were completely exhausted with no time to sleep.
En men was natuurlijk ontzettend vermoeid. Men had geen pauze om slaap te doen of zo.
So from Wednesday, the last night on the bridge, there was still hope that the 30th Army Corps would arrive from Nijmegen.
De nacht dat men op de brug heeft gezeten, geprobeerd en gehoopt heeft dat de 30e legerkorps vanuit.
But on Thursday morning, it was over.
Donderdagochtend was het afgelopen.
They were taken prisoner, and the bridge was in German hands. John Frost and around 700 men held the northern approach to the Rhine Bridge in Arnhem for 4 days and 3 nights. an extremely heroic deed, when you realize that their German enemy had many more men and much heavier weapons. Nijmegen is liberated and the bridges are captured. Frost and his men are prisoners of war and the Rhine Bridge is again in German hands. It's almost impossible for British ground troops to cross the Rhine and push on to Berlin. Operation Market Garden is in serious danger.
We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies chase those dark clouds far away.
It's Thursday morning on the 21st of September. 4 days after it was launched, Operation Market Garden is in grave danger. The Germans again firmly control the Rhine Bridge at Arnhem, and the Allies are finding it impossible to cross the river. But the Americans and British refuse to accept defeat and want to fight on to the bitter end. This third part deals with the importance of Driel and Oosterbeek in the next phase of the operation. We were standing in front of our house and we heard another group, a formation of transport planes, approaching south of Driel. They hadn't yet crossed the Arnhem-Nijmegen rail line. Suddenly we saw paratroops, huge numbers of them. They turned out to be Polish. We are all still in the cellar. My father was upstairs in the kitchen. He called out, "The Krauts have landed on the other side, at Janssen's." It was a small grocer's shop. I was curious, so I went upstairs and squinted through the window of the barn. And there they were, an SS-er with a typical German helmet and a machine gun on the windowsill. The British were behind us. There was no fighting, but they started to advance. We went to the Rhine dike. There were warnings, don't go up onto the dike, it's dangerous, because the Germans were probably still in Oosterbeek and they would shoot at us. So we lay down there and peered over the dike with binoculars. Very dangerous. They created a sort of smoke screen, and when that blew over us, you couldn't see the bridge anymore. It looked like a thick mist, but it was chemical stuff. They did it to defend the bridge because at night the Germans came back and fired at the bridge. It was a very exciting time. The next morning, we thought we heard a strange sound. Someone came out of the cellar and said, "The house is on fire." They had shot at the house and set it on fire. Every day was the same. We lived in Sijpendaal, where the anti-aircraft guns, which defended the airspace above the Betuwe, were located. At 3 every afternoon, you could set your watch by it. The Tommies arrived to attack the guns.
Dan kwamen de Tommies en dan kreeg je een aanval op die luchtafweergeschutten.
In September 1944, this beautiful building was the Hartenstein Hotel. Nowadays, it's the Airborne Museum. After the troops landed, it soon became the headquarters of the British general Roy Urquhart. When the British realize it's impossible to break through German lines, they abandon their attempt to reach the Rhine Bridge. They withdraw to Hartenstein Hotel to plan their next moves.
Kijk, op deze kaart.
This map clearly shows the situation. Hartenstein Hotel is here. The entire area inside this line is in British hands. Outside it, the Germans are in control. Down here is the Rhine. This area was called the perimeter.
Perimeter, dat is een wiskundige term die door de Britten vaker in militaire situaties wordt gebruikt.
You can see that the British are completely surrounded and are waiting desperately for help from Allied ground forces. In the meantime, the advance units of the British Army are in Lent, where they bivouac for the night. The rest are still in Brabant. The road used by the British to push north through Brabant is soon nicknamed Hell's Highway. Montgomery has not only underestimated the German forces at Arnhem, but also the resistance in Brabant. The battle for Hell's Highway lasts for days. At various times, the Germans recapture sections, thereby splitting the British forces. The advance faces more delays. They should have been in Gelderland a long time ago. The next morning, Thursday the 21st of September, the advance units move forward from Lent to the north under the command of General Horrocks. As the British slept, the German SS Panzer divisions have all the time to block the main road to Arnhem. Unsuspectingly, the advance units head north. From Lent, they cross the Griftdijk, and here, exactly at this crossroads, the Germans ambush them. Their tanks come under fire, and heavy fighting continues until 1900 hours. The Germans prove to be too formidable an obstacle for the Allies. General Horrocks is in serious trouble. More British appeared in the neighborhood in the course of the week, at our house too. They defended themselves against the Germans. The Germans continually advanced from the east and tried to penetrate the perimeter, the last area in the hands of the British. It wasn't easy fighting the Germans. While we children spent most of the time in the cellars, the British were on the ground and first floors, firing at the Germans on the other side of the street.
Op de begane grond en boven in ons huis om die Duitsers aan de overkant van de weg en achter de huizen daar te bestoken.
I once went to the neighbors. They were upstairs having a meal. I told them to go downstairs, because it was dangerous up there. They stayed put, otherwise their food would have got cold. I went back later. They were dead. A grenade had been thrown at them. Upstairs became too gruesome. We dressed the children and went downstairs. There was a large fridge in the shop, the back of which led to a large office. There was a large stove. I think we prayed non-stop to the Holy Mary. It was so terrible. Huge lumps of rubble crashing through the windows. It was awful. There was hand-to-hand combat in the turf strat. Terrible noise. In de turfstraat, het was niet om aan te horen. 23 september. On the 23rd of September, the German tank division, the Totenkopf, or Death's Head, pulled into the farm drive. Die kwamen de eigen weg af, de boerderij op. My father was forced with a rifle in his back to open all the doors to the barns, to inspect them. Kreeg hij dat geweer, moest hij alle schuurdeuren open doen om te kijken. They were afraid there were British hidden inside. Then they ordered us to leave. Toen gebeurd was, kregen wij het bevel om de boerderij te verlaten. Dus toen hebben we daar gezeten. So we stayed there till Tuesday. Then the Ostkommandant arrived. He came down to the cellar to warn us to put cotton wool in our ears on Tuesday and that we should leave everything open to reduce the pressure. Allemaal watjes in de oren moesten doen, luiken openzetten, dat die luchtdruk weg kon. They had set up the Big Bertha gun in the market square next to the phone booth. The first shot destroyed the entire turf strat. The houses fell like matches. All of them. De hele voorgevel bij ons was niks meer. Advancing towards Arnhem, it seems as if the Germans are too powerful for General Horrocks. he has to abandon his plan to break through to the Rhine Bridge. At this point, the Allies discard their original plan and devise an alternative route. Now the Rhine Bridge is not so essential to reach the other side of the river. The new route runs through Driel. If they can construct a pontoon bridge to the Oosterbeek perimeter, Operation Market Garden can still be saved. On the Thursday, Driel has become an important location, as the plan envisages using small boats to cross the Rhine to deliver men and material to the perimeter in Oosterbeek. The Poles, who had been dropped in Driel, were to reinforce the British paratroops in Oosterbeek. The plan was to use the Driel ferry, but it was no longer operational. So the crossing was made at night to the north bank of the Rhine with two or three men in rubber boats each time, including ammunition and weapons to defend the perimeter positions.
The Poles, we expected them to join up with us, which would make us stronger, to make up for the men we'd lost, also the ammunition, because we were running short of ammunition and food and men. There's quite a few wounded. And with the Poles coming over, it swelled the ranks a bit. All we needed was men, ammunition and food.
After the bridge at Arnhem had again fallen into German hands, the battalions in Arnhem were withdrawn to Oosterbeek. A perimeter was formed at the headquarters at Hartenstein.
By September 20th, the fourth day, Urquhart has his headquarters established at the Hotel Hartenstein in nearby Oosterbeek. The hotel tennis courts serve as a POW cage for some 250 prisoners, including a lone Japanese taken at Arnhem, perhaps the only Japanese captured in action in Europe. In the perimeter, a horseshoe pocket 1,000 yards wide, 2,000 yards deep, are jammed 3,500 survivors of the 1st British Airborne, Germans on three sides, the Rhine River at their backs.
We moved from Wolfhays around the Utterbeck area. In the woods, we ended up in the woods. Everybody concentrated around there more or less, but it was spread out. You only seen your own men, unless you've seen somebody trying to make their own way back to the units or something like that. But I didn't even know the headquarters was in the Hartenstein, the Hartenstein Hotel. That's where the headquarters were.
The aim of the perimeter was to form a bridgehead on the north bank of the Rhine and then to extend it and link up with the south side.
Om daar op den duur dat brughoofd uit te breiden en indien dat mogelijk was een verbinding te maken met de zuidzijde om vanaf daar.
From there, men and material could be shipped to the north bank, creating a jumping off point to push forward to the IJsselmeer region and the Ruhr. The British at Oosterbeek are trapped like rats. Their food and ammunition is running out. On the other side, they can see the Allied attempts to cross the river. But only a few manage to reach the perimeter. Therefore, the British are entirely dependent on the provisions and ammunition dropped on the outskirts of the village using these baskets. But radio communication is so bad, the pilots are unaware of the fact, or learn too late, that the dropping zones have been recaptured by the Germans. So, The Germans, rather than the British, make use of the supplies the British so desperately need. There was a surgeon who heard I could speak English. There was an emergency operation. Would I help him? I told him I wasn't even a nurse. I'd only done a first aid course. That was all. I had never seen someone else's blood, only my own. But as best I could, I helped with an amputation. It wasn't all that difficult, but it was very emotional because the anesthesia was very primitive. We could only give him a few injections. We soon saw the British had left and the Germans had taken their place. They came into our house. "Are the Tommies here?" they asked. They had long gone, but the Germans didn't dare look in the cellar. They thought it was too dangerous, so they took our word for it. But they saw from the military equipment in the house that the British must have been here. But what could we do? A sip of water? Talk to them a little? Hold a hand? I wasn't a nurse, so I could only provide human contact. It was a very strange situation.
Contact and yeah, it was natuurlijk een hele vreemde situatie.
Eventually, you got used to it. Every day, another body lay in the wielerbaan, or a leg stuck out of the mud. Bulldozers cleared it up later. All you could see was that leg. I still have a look there, but it's long gone. Life in the perimeter is very hard. The British survive on rations, and ammunition is dwindling. Many soldiers die or are wounded. But despite all the setbacks, the British hold their line.
It was frightening. But it was laughable. If you didn't laugh, you wouldn't live. And if you didn't look after each other, you wouldn't have lived. You try to make life as best you can. It's no use sitting there miserable, because you'd end up a dead man. And that's all you had to do, cheer each other up, crack a joke now and again, settle down to it, and that was it. Otherwise, we'd have all been dead.
The battles in the perimeter varied. In the east, fighting took place in houses, while on the other side of the perimeter, it mainly occurred in the woods. The advantage of fighting in woods meant it was easier to defend. The disadvantage of fighting in houses was that as soon as a house was set alight by enemy fire, the men had to withdraw to other positions. The British had radio contact with the south, with an artillery unit at Nijmegen. The unit fired on the German positions on the perimeter from a distance of 17 kilometers. And they could fairly accurately hit them, whereby it was possible to retain control of the perimeter.
Well, there wasn't really a lot we could do only to defend ourselves. They were firing at us, coming at us. But they were using the same tactics as us, waiting till the darkness came to attack us. And the dawn, which was natural every morning, we got a salvo of guns for an hour or so, keep our heads down. And then one afternoon, they tried to raid us. And we lost a few men. We lost a platoon officer, the brigade sergeant major, two corporals, and the lance corporal and some men. And the lance sergeant, who was a friend of mine, lived over the water, Archie Owens. He came over to me and he says, "Come with me," he said, "I can see some Germans." I said, "Where?" He said, "Come with me," he said, "we'll try and wipe them out." It was on like a side of a fence in the woods, and we were crawling along. And he said, there they are. They're on a machine gun. He said, have you got your grenades with you? And I said, no, because you've been moving light. I had a bandolier of ammunition around me and my rifle. He said, go back and get some grenades. I went back, picked a couple of grenades up. And he goes back, he's lying behind a tree with a bullet through his neck. And he was shouting, don't leave me to die. And there's nothing I could do for him. I grabbed him, pulled him, tugged him, and brought him back into the area. And I believe the medic came, and I believe he took him down with the farmer and his wife and kids, waiting to take him to the hospital. But I was told afterwards he died at 8 o'clock at night.
On Sunday and Monday, the British only had supplies for a few days. It was the intention that during the operation, the rest would be dropped by plane in the special zones set aside for resupply.
Gedropt zou worden op van tevoren bepaalde landingszones voor de bevoorrading.
But these zones quickly fell into German hands, and many supplies on these days and in the weeks that followed were also captured by the Germans. Only around 30% of the supplies actually reached the British.
I see the one wave came over, and I seen a flight lieutenant Lord get the VC. He came in and they were dropping supplies, but they weren't coming near as the Germans were getting them, because we closed the perimeter in and we weren't in the spot where they should have been dropped, because we had to close ranks. But as your men go down, you've got to close the ranks. You can't keep the area. You've not enough men to keep it, so you close in. And they were dropping them in the wrong place. If the Germans had knew the situation we were in, they could have taken us out, because we had nothing to defend ourselves with. They had the tanks. They had the heavy guns. We had nothing. And if the Germans had concentrated and moved forward, they could have took us all out. But I think they were just as major. The fighting spirit of the men was good, no doubt about it.
The situation is virtually hopeless. The British still retain control of the perimeter, but German pressure increases every day. On the other side, in Driel, the Allies attempt to cross the river with little success. The majority of the Allied army en route to the north are still fighting in Brabant, although a small unit has managed to reach Driel. Will they arrive on time to establish a bridgehead to the perimeter before it falls entirely to the Germans?
Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies chase those dark clouds far away. And I will just say hello to the folks that you know.
In part three, we saw how the Allies are unable to stick to the original route for Market Garden. The Germans impede the Rhine crossing at Arnhem. The British, whose aim was to seize the Rhine Bridge, have withdrawn to the so-called perimeter in Oosterbeek. Their situation is precarious. They are completely surrounded by German SS panzer divisions. To save the operation, the British and Americans devise a plan to construct a pontoon bridge over the Rhine between Driel and the perimeter. It is Saturday, the 23rd of September, when General Horrocks and the advanced British ground forces arrive in Driel. They have brought 14 canvas boats. That same evening, a group of Polish military crossed the Rhine. The situation in the perimeter is worsening by the hour. Part 4 of Market Garden deals with the fall of the perimeter and the last phase of the operation.
In the kelder, gewoon.
We waited and listened in the cellar. What was going on outside? Is it safe again? So you went back upstairs as best you could. But it was so dangerous that it was wiser to spend more time in the cellar.
De meeste tijd en steeds vaker in de kelder door te brengen.
Nee.
No, they just sort of slipped away. Then you thought, such young boys, because most of them were very young boys.
De angst over.
Fear ruled, and you didn't care about anything else then. For example, I've no idea what we then ate.
Ik had eigenlijk nog nooit, behalve misschien mijn grootvader.
Apart from maybe my grandfather, I'd never seen corpses. Now, suddenly, they lay all around you. Later, when the battle was over, I helped drag the bodies away. Bodies from the hospital, to where they had to be buried directly. That sort of thing was beyond your comprehension. I mean, you didn't know beforehand if you could do it. But in certain situations, you can do a lot more than you imagine.
Dus de volgende dag moesten we vertrekken, maar niet overdag.
So the next day we had to leave, but not during daylight, in the evening, and not towards the Allies. My father had asked if we should head for the Tommies, but it was out of the question. We stayed on the German side, into the Reichswald no less, so into a large forest, in the dark, with a pram and a couple of wheelbarrows. It was an awful situation.
En daar leek het net de uittocht van Egypte.
It was just like the exodus from Egypt. Prams, bikes, handcarts, delivery bicycles, a whole column. On the right-hand side of the road, towards Beekbergen, Apeldoorn. On the other side were the Germans, heading for Arnhem with their tanks, because the Allies had promised not to fire during the two-day evacuation, and naturally, the Germans took advantage of it. The Germans see through the Allies' plan to construct a pontoon bridge between Driel and the perimeter. And so they make life difficult for the Poles in Driel. They are bombarded with mortar shells from the north and east. As a result, many farms and houses in Driel are set on fire. Flying shrapnel also kills many animals. All in all, only 200 Polish military managed to reach the British in the perimeter. Not nearly enough to keep the Germans, who surround the entire area, at a distance. But the military in the perimeter put up a brave fight, because they know how important it is to maintain the perimeter until the rest of the ground forces arrive. For Operation Market Garden to succeed, it's vital that the pontoon bridge between Driel and Oosterbeek is constructed as soon as possible. But the bridge elements are still at the rear of the British ground forces, which are still in Brabant. The Germans maintain their pressure and manage to continuously slow down the advance of the troops along Hell's Highway. But delaying the ground forces isn't the only problem. German superiority in the area around Driel and Oosterbeek is such that it's impossible to construct a pontoon bridge. The Allies are subjected to massive German bombardments from the Westerbach. This is the Westerbauing, and it's in German hands. As such, they have a perfect strategic location. From here, you can overlook the entire area behind it. The church tower at Driel, even Nijmegen. On that side, the rail bridge at Arnhem and the Eusebius church. In between lies the perimeter. With the Westerbauing, the Germans have control of an impregnable fortress. The British and Poles attempt to capture it, but fail. Some boats reach the other side, but it's impossible to climb the steep banks. The Germans mow everyone down. As long as the Westerbauing is in German hands, it's inconceivable that the pontoon bridge can be built. So the 200 Poles returned. And that night they dug in at the Driel ferry. Very early the next day they went back to Driel, which was now full of Poles.
En toen de gewonden kwamen.
When the casualties arrived, some were so badly wounded they couldn't write. They wanted so much to write a letter home. The question was asked, can any of the volunteers speak English? So the wounded could dictate to them. I said, yes, I'll do it. Then the Germans fired a lot of grenades. I don't think it was intended to cause a lot of casualties. I suspect they did it to scare away the local people, so that they didn't have to be bothered by them, and so they could better get at the Polish forces.
Nou ja, wat zij mij.
Well, the things they dictated to me, what they had been through, and that they were terribly wounded, and they hoped to see each other again. That was roughly what they said.
Dus het was buiten.
So outside it was very quiet. Inside, dark and frightening and waiting. That's about all I can say about it. The children became irritating and that was annoying. People said, what do we do now? Just sit here? Can't we go out? That's what it's like. Everyone is restless and it's very irritating. It is Sunday the 24th of September, and here in the Drill Church Tower there are three commanders, Horrocks, Sozabowski and Thomas. They survey the Rhine towards Oosterbeek. What they see is dramatic. The military in the perimeter are surrounded on all sides. Only a few elements of the ground forces are here in Drill. And it's clear, German superiority is simply too powerful. Only one course of action is possible. The Allies would have to abandon their positions and end Operation Market Garden. On Monday, the decision was taken to withdraw the remnants, the men who remained in the perimeter, to the south of the Rhine. It no longer made sense to maintain this position. It was costing too many lives. The decision was taken on the Monday to Tuesday night to withdraw to the south. Two routes were chosen, which ran from the north side of the perimeter to the river. And the men made their way there in small groups, in the dark, the rain and wind, because that night there was a terrible storm. The wounded remained behind along with the medical staff, while the rest attempted to reach the Rhine in the dark. There are four units with boats which would transport the men in the dark, but the Germans got wind of the plan. At least, they thought that reinforcements were being ferried into the north. So they lay down heavy fire on the crossing point. As a result, some are wounded and some drown during the crossing.
When we looked around the trenches, everybody had gone. And Chris Carroll and myself were left on our own. I said, what are we going to do? Do you know where you are? I said, I don't. I said, I know I'm in Holland, but I don't know whereabouts. We hadn't a clue where we were. All we were told was to follow the star shells, which were being fired from Nijmegen way. Get between them, and you'll hit the Rhine. So I said, come on, we'll have a go. Soaking wet, teeming with rain, and all of a sudden I heard a voice come out of the woods saying, help me, help me. I said, it's one of our lads. And when I looked, it was a wounded soldier, and he was one of our platoon. Albert Shaw, he'd been wounded in the groin. It was a funny story, that, because a few days earlier, when I tell you about the airbase shells, he was standing by our trench and he got hit And he said, oh, I've been hit. I said, where? He said, down here. And we cracked the joke. Said, well, you've got another one left. You're all right. And he started laughing. Eventually, we reached the Rhine, or round Westerbotten, and I seen all the men queuing up. And he said, I said, can you get the wounded chap abroad? He said, take him down to the front. He said, no chance of getting a boat, because I believe there was only a few boats there. They'd broken down or something. So I said, well, let's go lower down and see if we can find something. There's a big cafe there or something, it's west about and whatnot. And I said, we might be able to find a rowing boat. As we were going down, a couple of others followed us. And the next thing we heard, the chugging of a boat coming over, and a voice shouted out, hang on, you can get in here. When the boat pulled in, it was a Canadian engineer on his own. He said, I said, I've got a wounded chap. He said, put him up in the front. So we got him up in the front. And he said, well, get on, the rest got on. And the boat was full then. So he started off towards the other side, and the boat broke down. So we all started rowing with our hands and the rifle butts. He started the boat up again, and eventually we reached the other side of the Rhine. Everybody scattered and left the three of us there. We're on the other side now, so we were all right. And we started to walk, and we're falling in dikes, going down, rain, water, soaked to the skin. And then eventually we saw a light on the side, on the like a road. Made our way towards the light, and there was a soldier there from one of the army, the Devons or somebody. I said, what's this? He said, it's like a first aid post, he said. I said, I've got a wounded bloke here. He said, can you do anything for him? He said, there's a jeep coming down in a minute, he said. He'll take the wounded man, but he won't take you. I said, we don't want to go, we'll walk. He said, Nijmegen's not far away, he said, about 10 miles. So eventually a jeep came down with two soldiers on, two medics, and he took the wounded chap off us. And he went, well, he's safe, he's gone. I said, when I get home, I'll go to your wife's house. I knew where he lived. We eventually, the fella said to us, you better keep moving because they're going to bombard this area. It's daylight. So we kept moving and walking and walking and walking, and eventually we saw the bridge in Nijmegen.
That last boat's had it. I'm going to swim for it. Every man for himself.
In the ochtend, als het licht is, is het niet meer mogelijk om het.
In the morning, as day dawns, crossing to the other side in boats is impossible. The only way is to swim to the south bank. Many drown, or are later taken prisoner, on the north side of the Rhine. One of the routes used for the evacuation runs via this old church in Oosterbeek, which is an assembly point. On Tuesday, the 26th of September, at 5:30 in the morning, the last boats ferry the wounded to the other side. Day is already dawning. The Germans have a clear view of the boats and start firing at them. So it becomes too dangerous to risk crossing. Here in Oosterbeek, around 300 wounded men remain. Looking back on the entire operation, around 11,000 men landed on the north bank of the Rhine. Of them, 2,400 are evacuated that night. The rest are captured or dead. Then we knew that the Battle of Arnhem Well, at that time we didn't know it was the Battle of Arnhem. We knew it had been lost, and the Germans still remained in control. And the front line was established in Groesbeek. At one point, my father had a remark from some German soldiers. They said to each other, "Arnhem is ours again." That's still a part of my life. Really, it is. I experienced a few bombardments in Germany, but this was much more personal. You thought, is that person still alive? Is my brother still alive? Is so-and-so still alive? It made such an impression. It never leaves you. What did we know about war? Cannons and firing and danger? We didn't know anything about it. You had scarcely heard anything about it for 4 years. You were just frightened. You were scared. Dead scared. I felt really sorry for the other side of the river. I mean, we were liberated. But it went wrong over there.
Angst.
Fear. People screaming. Children crying. Noise like you can't imagine. It was terrible. And you were helpless. Because you had to leave. You simply had to go. Walk. Just walk and try to save yourself. I'm just astounded as I stand here about how many memories and images come to the surface. Everyone who was there, everyone could write a book about it. The plan for Market Garden, devised by Field Marshal Montgomery, has been partly carried out. The south of the Netherlands has been liberated, but the north is still occupied. Market Garden is part success, part failure. At Arnhem, Market Garden failed and the consequences were disastrous. The failure of the Battle of Arnhem, Operation Market Garden, meant that the war in Europe lasted another 6 months, giving rise to the hunger winter in the west of the Netherlands. That cost thousands of Dutch their lives. The operation was decided upon much too quickly. It had to be prepared in much too short a time. Moreover, just about everything worked against it. They overestimated themselves. They thought, we've raced through northern France and Belgium, so we can do this too. There was a sort of winning mood. German resistance was completely underestimated.
But I still couldn't understand why they didn't send ground troops through. Okay, you couldn't get tanks through. Well, you could get ground troops through. And if they'd have got ground troops through, we'd have been a bit better off. Because a lot of us were tired and weary. Did a boosted armour all a lot. It did have showed their faces. But it didn't happen.
The culture in the British Army was entirely different from the Americans. The Americans wanted to go straight at their target, while the British were more careful. They took their time. They drank tea at 4 o'clock next to their tanks. The radios used during the Battle of Arnhem were not suitable for this area. This is a wooded, hilly area, and as such, connections could neither be established with the nearby units in Nijmegen nor with England. In the beginning, some homing pigeons were used. They managed to get some messages through to England, but it only went downhill from then on. Another important reason was the lack of air support. It was requested, but never provided.
I think myself, my own opinion, I don't think it was organised properly. The way they said it was organised, it would have been good if it had come off, and the war would have been finished. The only regret I had, it never come off. And when we left Arnhem and Oosterbeek, the Gelderland, we went in and we helped to destroy cities, and we came out and we left them, the poor Dutch, on their own, which they suffered before we went in. They suffered when they were in there, and they suffered when we came out.
How do you feel about that?
I feel rotten. I do. Because when we went back to Arn, the hospitality they gave us was out of this world. You couldn't believe it. The lads even say now, they say, we left this place in a right mess, and the way these people treat us, they treat us like children. They do. And this was the only regret I had. We couldn't help them. I've been in other countries, and nobody's ever been anything like this. I've got a lot of affection for the Dutch people, and I'd go there any time. And you've got to believe it. And our lads do.
Yes, it was here. When we first entered the town center on Sunday the 17th, it was quiet. Although one of our rank had already died, shot once in the Velperstraat. We didn't even know who he was, a new recruit. He just dropped dead next to me, shot through the heart. Yes. Well, my name is Horst Weber. I'd arrived 2 days previously from Diepenveen. We were billeted in a farm next to a restaurant there. We saw the planes in the sky on the Sunday afternoon. At the time we thought they were heading for Berlin, and we swore at them. We said, now they're going to destroy Berlin. But they weren't. They turned round and flew back to England. They were here, but we couldn't know that. The air was full of planes. And suddenly the order came, get ready, get everything ready, alarm, alarm status, and so on. There were about 150 of us. We climbed onto trucks fueled by wood gas, and they dropped us close to Arnhem. They told us to go straight ahead under the tunnel, and we'd find a large open piece of ground, a recreation ground. There were two streets, and it was called Muses Sacrum. So we got there and waited. When I say we, I mean there were about 15 of us, but more arrived, and later even more from other places.
Diese 15 haben sich dann auch summiert, es kamen dann wieder andere von woanders her. Und als wir dann hier waren, war dann irgendein Mann hier.
When we got here, someone asked who we were, where we came from, and who was in command.
Der fragte, wer seid ihr, wo kommt ihr her?
I said I was in command.
Haben wir gedacht, wo wir herkommen, wer führt euch?
At first he was very skeptical, because we had no leader or non-commissioned officers. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. We said we could do the job. It was almost insulting that he didn't trust us. There was a small pile of weapons over there. He showed us them and said, go grab something to shoot with, hurry! There's a slope there. Go and find the Königstraat, follow it all the way, and you come to a large square with a church. If you march straight on, you'll come to the Rhine. Go there and turn left towards the bridge. So, off we went. It was that simple. It was here. We had two dead, shot through the head. Not here, but a little bit further.
Die waren hier etwa oder auf der Seite
wahrscheinlich,
jawohl. Und das ist verbrieft.
It was written up in a report.
Und daraufhin gingen wir zur Seite. Ich ging auch kurz zur Seite und sagte dann, also los. Dann
I said, come on, we have to drag them down here, because they were up there. The tower was about 20 meters higher, there was a small dome on top. There were shadows, always moving around up there, heads moving back and forward. Then my mates with the machine gun said they were going to fire at them. There were snipers up there, and we wanted a bit of peace and quiet. I walked back, and when I threw myself to the ground, to be able to observe everything, they began shooting. And that was it. It was that easy. So we set off again, because we knew that we wouldn't be shot at from up there anymore. That was our first bad experience. The dead. We had been in battle, so we knew what it was like then. In fact, we were in the middle of the fighting from the very first day. It made us strong. On Monday morning, we contacted the forces next to us. We went back to Königstraat because we had heard that some British were still hiding there.
Weil wir hörten, dass da noch Engländer überall versteckt wären. Und das wollten wir ja nun nicht haben.
We didn't like that. An enemy to the front and an enemy at the rear. Half of my small group returned here with me, and the rest stayed there on guard.
Zurück und die andere Hälfte blieb dort und sicherte.
When we got to this side, this is where we first shot some British out of a cellar with an alarm pistol. They ran outside. When we had shot at them with other weapons, at first they didn't want to. But when they saw the alarm pistol shell in the cellar, they came out fast. Beside it, or a couple of houses further on this side, was a house with couches. On this side there was a cinema or a small theatre. We pulled them out from among the rows of seats. They immediately surrendered and offered no resistance. So we marched with these 12 to 18 men towards the Duivel's house. We locked them up in the cellar. In the afternoon, the British complained that they hadn't had anything to drink. We hadn't anything to drink either, and I didn't know where to find anything. We didn't even notice we were hungry. It was all so exciting and new, so interesting, so successful, that we didn't let ourselves get hungry. So I set off and just here walked down the Arche Noachstraat and turned second right. There was a small market with women who had stuff to sell, including, among other things, pears. I told one of the women I needed them for the British prisoners. She even believed me. I mean, it was true. So I went back and gave the British the pears. They were very pleased with them. In fact, they should remember this. And if any of them sees this in Britain, I'd be really pleased to hear from those old comrades. This door here, yes, at least 50 to 60 British prisoners went through this door. They were happy that they could shelter here with us. Some were lost, some wounded, some badly wounded. We kept them here, depending on who was here at the time, because we'd just been fighting ourselves. But we also had to man a post here to receive messages. Those messages came from the battle station Sonnenstuhl at the Singel on the corner of the Parkstraat. Later it got very full here. It was fullest when Dr. Logan, the young English captain and army doctor, was here. I think he enjoyed all the things this young scoundrel did for him. He just wanted to hand over his men in a decent way, so that they could finally get the correct medical treatment. We didn't have any transport to take away the wounded. Nothing was organized. Absolutely nothing.
And then was a treppe.
There was a stair on the left, going down. We kept the British prisoners we had captured on the Monday in the Königstraat down there. They couldn't escape. Yes. Yes, this is the cellar. This is the cellar. But it's been done up to look old. It's not like what it was. But it is the cellar. But it's not the same space where I had to take care of our British prisoners.
Den ich hatte zur Betreuung der Engländer, unseren Gefangenen. Ah. Moment.
Wait a second. This is the Eusebius Church, there is the Rhine, and behind me is the St. Walburgers Church. It's all coming back to me. Let's take a look. This was certainly not here, because the space stopped here. Otherwise, they could have escaped out the back. There was a stairway there, a spiral staircase, because when I went down, they could all see me. I never talked to them at eye level, and I never went in. Better safe than sorry. So I stood at the top of the stairs, but unarmed. We trusted each other.
Wir haben uns schon vertraut gegenseitig. Aber das macht man ja nicht. Also das war auch nicht diese Erhöhung.
This wasn't here either. This raised bit. And the wall was narrower. It was
enger
here.
Gewesen sein. Also hier
you went down the stairs here, and this was the space.
Und vor allen Dingen, da war das Fenster.
The window was there, where I'm pointing. The window was there, where the niche now is. You can see where it was in old drawings.
Alten Zeichnungen erkennen. Ja. So war es. Hier waren sie drin und
this is where we held them and they were safe.
Geschehen.
They were better off than us. Upstairs, we could always get a bullet through the head.
Da oben immer noch eins gewischt bekommen, wie man so sagt. Ja, schön, dass ich
it's good that I can see all this again.
Ich würde mich so riesig freuen,
I would be really pleased if I could be here with my British comrades again, even if there were only a few of them.
Oder nur einige davon. Es leben bestimmt noch welche.
A few are still alive. They were only a few years older than me. Some were 20, 21, 22. Some had already fought at Monte Cassino. Others had been in Normandy. I was here on this road on Thursday the 21st, about 12:30. This was a situation. Our support post in the Davos House, the old town hall, had been cleared. Most of the men were already on their way to Elst. But the British prisoners were still inside. They were inside, it was closed, and there were trucks and ambulances that had come from the Königstraat. The seriously wounded had already been moved, and the army doctor, Captain Logan, had gone with them. You can now get an idea of our condition in those days. I can hardly understand myself. It was almost as if we, the German soldiers, had been hypnotized.
We'd
been together for 2 or 3 days, and we parted in good spirits. I said to Logan, bye-bye in London, as if we were actually going there. It was the only way to get through it. We were all young and enthusiastic. We had to be. How was it possible? So they all came out here and there was a huge pile of weapons. We had to take into account that they might try and grab them. So I stood at a distance so I wouldn't be hit. I stood just here with my gun around my neck, and suddenly someone remained standing next to the door. So I went over. I was about a meter away from him. He was here. It was Frost. He marched his men past, probably for a last goodbye. They didn't know what was going to happen. And then I asked him, what's the matter? What are you doing here? And then he said, I'm the commander.
I'm the commander.
I was a nobody to him. Naturally, I mean, I felt like a nobody. I immediately took the correct stance and I nodded to him. And he kept staring at me. He really was an honorable man. There were two seriously wounded British sitting against the wall. One with open leg wounds. And the other had almost lost his leg completely. He couldn't move at all. His leg was virtually severed. And I wanted to help get them inside so they could leave immediately with the other wounded.
Noch reinzuschleppen, damit sie noch gleich mit dem Transport der Verwundeten mitgehen konnten. Da schlagen zwei
andere. Two other British, who were lying on the ground about 3 meters away from me, suddenly opened their eyes. They weren't dead at all. They only pretended to be, so that they could rejoin their units on the other side of the Rhine and continue fighting. The last men who fell with Colonel Frost fought like lions. So I said to them, come on, hands up.
Come on, hands up.
And all three of us started laughing, and they got up. I stepped back a bit and said, look at your comrades who are helping you inside. Then they helped pick up the wounded with their legs dangling beneath them. They took them into the holding area so they could be taken away later. I hope they survived. This has to be said. The man in command here, and who led us fantastically through all this, was Major Sonnenstuhl. He was our leader. In fact, our coupled together group of soldiers was named after him, the Sonnenstuhl Fighting Unit. Take a look at these photos. Oh, perhaps this is better. I'll dry them off. This is the bank of the Rhine, behind it the Eusebius Church, and there is the bridge. The raindrops look like tears. I realized after the war, first of all, I was grateful that I had survived unscathed. How many didn't? I realized that we were horribly misused. The entire population of Germany was misused. I learned that you can't be critical enough when it comes to politicians, especially politicians who promise you the world. You have to recognize it when it begins. You have to act as soon as a government begins to act like a dictator. You have to be brave enough to take action. Don't think it's nothing to do with me, because it's got everything to do with all of us. That's my opinion. People don't want war. No one wants war. That's the highest calling, and you have to be alert right from the beginning. Fight against it right from the start. We didn't do that with Hitler.